Muy buenas tardes. Les damos la bienvenida a esta conferencia, que es la segunda conferencia del ciclo que venimos desarrollando con el CER desde el curso pasado. Como saben muchos de ustedes que tuvieron ocasión de asistir a la primera serie, estas conferencias formaban parte inicialmente de la celebración del 60 aniversario del CER, que se acordó que en España pues fuera a través de un ciclo de conferencias dirigidas a un público general. Estuvieron abiertas por el director científico del CER, el profesor Bertolucci, clausuradas el primer año por el director general del CER, el profesor Hoyer. Este segundo año se comenzó con un ciclo más corto de 3 conferencias. Adelanto que la voluntad es darle continuidad en los años siguientes, y hoy tenemos el placer de tener con nosotros pues a la doctora Gianotti, que será la nueva directora general del CER desde enero del 2016. Es un placer tenerla aquí con nosotros para hablarnos del CER y hablarnos de la siguiente fase, esta etiquetada como Run 2. Yo tengo que agradecer en primer lugar a José Miguel Jiménez, director de Departamento de Tecnología del CER, que ha sido junto con Javier Font un artífice en dar forma a la primera y a la segunda edición del ciclo. Por supuesto, hoy al profesor Cayetano López, catedrático de Física Teórica de la Universidad Autónoma de Madrid y director general del CIEMAT, que va a ser quien haga la introducción formal a contarnos brevemente el perfil del CER, y de la doctora Gianotti, que, como ustedes saben, y yo no me voy a extender en ello porque ahora lo contará con más precisión el profesor López, pues ha tenido una larga y distinguida carrera en el CER y concretamente en el periodo en el que el bosón de Higgs fue descubierto, probado. Agradezco también la presencia de las autoridades del Ministerio del Área de Ciencia, Tecnología e Innovación, especialmente la Secretaría de Estado de Investigación Desarrollo e Innovación, que es siempre una persona para nosotros muy cercana en esta casa. Sin más, le cedo la palabra al profesor Cayetano López para que haga la introducción. Muchas gracias.
Querida Secretaria de Estado de Investigación, Desarrollo e Innovación, querida Secretaria General de Ciencia, Tecnología e Innovación, querido Director General de la Fundación, querida Fabiola Gianotti, queridas amigas, amigos, colegas, en primer lugar, quiero agradecer a la Fundación BBVA la organización de esta serie de conferencias, que es parte de una sostenida, enérgica e inteligente política de apoyo a la ciencia, una actividad que merece la atención y el agradecimiento de la comunidad científica. Y gracias también por haber contado conmigo para presentar a Fabiola Gianotti y, a través de su persona, al CER. Gracias de nuevo. En el curso 1967-68, hace ya muchos años, cuando yo estaba finalizando la licenciatura en Ciencias Físicas en la Universidad Complutense, entonces llamada Universidad de Madrid, había un intenso clima de movilización política entre los estudiantes, en línea con el clima general imperante en los campus universitarios de todo el mundo. En nuestro caso, el componente, digamos, autóctono de la movilización era la lucha contra la dictadura de Franco. Y a la agitación general en toda la universidad se añadió durante ese curso académico una motivación particular en la carrera para los estudiantes de la carrera de Ciencias Físicas. Se protestaba contra la anunciada retirada de España del CERN y se reivindicaba nuestra permanencia y nuestra pertenencia a un organismo internacional que, para muchos de nosotros, aún sin tener muy claro lo que era en realidad, representaba un símbolo de excelencia científica y de cooperación internacional en el campo de la investigación. En aquella época se daban también esta clase de movilizaciones. España había pertenecido al CERN desde 1961. tan solo 7 años después de su fundación. Pero los retornos científicos habían sido muy escasos. En el ámbito de la física experimental solo participaba el grupo del CIEMAT, entonces llamado Junta de Energía Nuclear, único laboratorio capaz de contribuir de forma significativa a la construcción y operación de las grandes infraestructuras que constituyen el núcleo duro del CERN, así como al análisis de los datos que en ellas se generaban. Dicho sea de paso, fue entonces cuando yo entré en contacto con el grupo experimental de la Junta de Energía Nuclear, dirigido por Antoni Lloret en aquella época, y cuando me hice el firme propósito de ser uno de ellos, un físico experimental más. Circunstancias propias del sistema político de la época, que no vienen al caso ahora, frustraron para siempre mi deseo de convertirme en físico experimental de partículas elementales y me relegaron sin remedio, tras una larga peripecia, a la condición de físico teórico. La retirada se consumó en el año 1969. Por supuesto, las colaboraciones científicas ya establecidas, en particular con el CIEMAT y también con otros grupos emergentes, principalmente teóricos de diversas universidades españolas, continuaron, de forma que siguió habiendo presencia española en el CERN y participación en los experimentos realizados entonces en el PS, en el SPS, en el SPPBAR-S, así como en la preparación de los experimentos a realizar en LEP, el gran acelerador de electrones, el acelerador que requirió la excavación de un túnel de 27 kilómetros de circunferencia que hoy alberga precisamente al acelerador LHC, el colisionador de hadrones. En el año 1983, y dentro de las actuaciones conducentes a colocar a España en la escena internacional, con una presencia y una influencia que correspondiera mejor a nuestra realidad como país, una vez consumada la transición a un régimen democrático, volvimos a ser miembros del CERN. En esta ocasión, al contrario que en 1961, la reentrada vino acompañada por medidas para fortalecer nuestras propias capacidades en el campo a fin de hacer más productiva nuestra contribución al organismo. Medidas que tuvieron la mayor importancia para el futuro de la física de altas energías en nuestro país, si bien es verdad que no llegaron a alcanzar los objetivos, quizá demasiado ambiciosos, planteados en su lanzamiento. Y conviene recordar que en aquella época fue el CIEMAT quien se empleó a fondo para conseguir nuestra vuelta al CERN y muy especialmente Juan Antonio Arrubio, que merece un recuerdo en este acto, que fue director general de dicho organismo y que falleció en el año 2010 cuando todavía ejercía ese cargo. Yo fui nombrado entonces, en 1983, miembro del Consejo del CERN. El Consejo del CERN es el máximo órgano no ejecutivo del organismo en el que se sentaban y se sientan los representantes de los países miembros. Y en esa condición de delegado científico en el Consejo me mantuve unos 10 años aproximadamente. Hace ya 32 años de esto, año 1983, pero lo recuerdo como si fuera ahora. Tuve que llevar en mi primer viaje a Ginebra como delegado y como parte de los primeros pagos, un cheque de 11 millones de francos suizos, una barbaridad de dinero en aquella época, e incluso sospecho que ahora, que me quemaban la cartera hasta que lo entregué a los responsables del CERN. Coincidí en ese periodo con dos ilustres antecesores de Fabiola Gianotti en el cargo de directores generales, Herwig Schöpper y su compatriota Carlo Rubbia. Entonces se estaba en la fase de explotación del LEP, pero empezó a planearse ya la construcción del LHC, del gran colisionador de hadrones, vistas las dificultades del gran superconducting supercollider diseñado por los norteamericanos y que iba a construirse en Texas, en un túnel de nada menos que 87 kilómetros de circunferencia. Un proyecto que fue definitivamente abandonado en 1993. Ya entonces, en los años 80, los grupos españoles participaron en los experimentos realizados en LEP y hoy su contribución es relevante en todos los detectores del LHC. Yo ya conocía el CERN de mis estancias de investigación allí, anteriores, cada una de ellas con su historia y su anécdota, de las que por supuesto no hablaré aquí para no alargarme. Pero mi experiencia como delegado en el Consejo del CERN me sirvió para comprender su significado y su importancia simbólica y científica. En efecto, nació el CERN en los primeros años 50, antes del mercado común, embrión de la Unión Europea. Era un tiempo en el que Europa intentaba reconstruirse inmediatamente después de la Segunda Guerra Mundial. Un tiempo en el que se consideraba primordial, además de abordar ambiciosos programas científicos inalcanzables para los países europeos por separado, propiciar la colaboración en el campo, en un campo, el de la ciencia, que como muchos otros había sufrido profundas divisiones durante la guerra. Y a fe que se consiguieron los objetivos entonces imaginados. Hoy el CERN es sin discusión el Laboratorio Mundial de Física de Partículas, líder en el mundo en la frontera de las altas energías y al que acuden científicos y grupos de científicos de todo el mundo. Es un ejemplo valioso de lo que los países de Europa son capaces de conseguir cuando se unen y colaboran en un objetivo común. La finalidad del CERN es profundizar en el conocimiento de los componentes más elementales de la materia y comprender las leyes que rigen su comportamiento. Es decir, investigación básica, a la que a veces se menosprecia como carente de utilidad social. Por supuesto que la utilidad social no es el objetivo primordial del CERN, sino contestar a preguntas suscitadas por la curiosidad humana acerca de la naturaleza última del mundo en que vivimos. Esta es una finalidad perfectamente legítima que no necesita de mayores justificaciones. Pero además, como siempre ha ocurrido en la historia de la ciencia, el conocimiento, por muy básico que sea, genera aplicaciones, normalmente imprevistas, en otros campos, estos sí de intenso impacto social. Es lo que ocurrió con la web, nacida en ese laboratorio, cuyo impacto apenas puede exagerarse, o aplicaciones industriales y médicas de las técnicas desarrolladas para mejorar las prestaciones de los dispositivos experimentales. También, en el caso de España, nuestro trabajo en conexión con el CERN ha servido y sigue sirviendo para progresar en áreas relacionadas con las tecnologías de la información o de aceleradores. Además, por supuesto, de la formación de científicos y tecnólogos jóvenes en un ambiente de enorme calidad y competencia a escala global. Una vez dichas algunas palabras sobre el CERN, volvamos nuestra atención a la protagonista de la conferencia de esta tarde, Fabiola Gianotti, la nueva directora general designada del organismo que entrará en plenas funciones a partir del 1 de enero de 2016. Muchos de los que aquí estamos nunca olvidaremos la histórica sesión del 4 de julio de 2012 en el auditorio del CERN, yo la oí desde Madrid, en la que se anunció públicamente el descubrimiento del bosón de Higgs. En esa ocasión, una científica italiana, de nombre Fabiola Gianotti, como responsable de la colaboración ATLAS, presentó los resultados obtenidos en ese detector que confirmaban, con muy poco espacio para la duda, la existencia de una nueva partícula, ya introducida como pura hipótesis más de 40 años antes y fundamental para cerrar nuestras teorías. Como profesor que he sido y sigo siendo, a pesar de todo, no puedo resistirme a decir una palabrita sobre el bosón de Higgs, a cuyo estudio contribuí muy modestamente el AS hace ya demasiado tiempo. Desde los años 60 se ha venido construyendo una teoría, la teoría estándar de las partículas elementales, también llamada modelo estándar, que constituye un caso, aunque no es el primero en la historia de la física, de unificación conceptual de un conjunto de fenómenos e interacciones que se manifiestan como diferentes desde el punto de vista empírico. Describe esta teoría las interacciones fuerte, electromagnética y débil, no así la gravitatoria, entre los componentes más básicos de la materia, quarks, leptones, gluones, fotón y bosones W y Z. Y es capaz de explicar y predecir la ingente cantidad de datos generados en décadas de investigación experimental. Real y literalmente asombroso el poder predictivo de esta teoría. Con un proviso, la teoría es renormalizable Es decir, sus predicciones tienen sentido solo para el caso en que la masa de todas las partículas mencionadas anteriormente sea cero, lo cual no es el caso, excepto para el fotón. La introducción en nuestras ecuaciones de términos ordinarios de masa rompe la simetría subyacente a la teoría y con ella la renormalizabilidad. Sin embargo, a partir de los años 60, se imaginó una extravagante manera de dotar de masa a las partículas sin romper esa propiedad, esa valiosa propiedad. ¿Cómo? Pues introduciendo un campo de estructura nada convencional que a través de un mecanismo conocido como mecanismo de Higgs transforma sus acoplamientos a cada partícula en términos de masa para cada una de ellas. Y este mecanismo preservaba las buenas propiedades de la teoría. Extraño, pero brillante. Por eso se dice, en mi opinión algo abusivamente, que el bosón de Higgs dota de masa a las partículas elementales que de otra forma no podrían tenerla en el contexto de la teoría estándar. El campo en cuestión implicaba la existencia de una nueva partícula, el llamado bosón de Higgs, una partícula muy especial, que no es como las otras, y que durante más de 40 años ha sido objeto de deseo de los experimentalistas, obstáculo que impedía dar por cerrada la teoría estándar y motivo de desconfianza de muchos físicos que sospechaban que ese mecanismo podría estar imitando o encubriendo algún otro proceso desconocido. Al tiempo, la dificultad para detectar experimentalmente esta partícula es mayúscula. Era y se ha demostrado que es mayúscula. De ahí la expectación suscitada por el descubrimiento de la partícula en cuestión, que mereció el Premio Nobel de Física para sus proponentes y a estos, junto con el CERN como institución, el Premio Príncipe de Asturias en nuestro país. Debo decir que fue una sorpresa, en realidad una revelación, ver y oír la brillante exposición de aquella investigadora en 2012, desconocida entonces para mí, aunque desde luego nada desconocida para la comunidad científica activa en el campo. Así que no es de extrañar que, llegando al término del actual director general del CERN, Rolf Hoyer, el Consejo designara a Fabiola en competición con varios muy cualificados candidatos como la próxima directora general. La primera mujer en el cargo en los más de 60 años de vida del laboratorio. Un hecho, este de ser la primera mujer en ocupar este cargo, que no es anecdótico, en mi opinión, sino que muestra un cierto, por lo menos un cierto progreso en el campo de la igualdad de géneros y nos hace pensar en lo mucho que la humanidad se ha perdido a lo largo de siglos y siglos de postergación de las mujeres. Su profundo conocimiento del CERN y de la física experimental de partículas elementales, acreditado a lo largo de su carrera, ha sido decisivo a la hora de llegar a ese desenlace y encaja perfectamente con el nivel de excelencia que prima en el CERN a la hora de cubrir los puestos de máxima responsabilidad. Pero no basta la experiencia, el conocimiento y la excelencia científica, que son condiciones necesarias para el cargo, pero no suficientes. Hace falta algo más. El CERN es una organización que involucra a más de 14.000 personas, entre científicos, ingenieros, estudiantes de posgrado, técnicos y personal de apoyo, de los que unos 11.000 son usuarios externos de sus instalaciones, pero proceden de todo el mundo. Resulta pues obvio que el trabajo desarrollado en el CERN tiene una importante componente de trabajo en equipo, integración de personas con sensibilidades, culturas y hábitos de trabajo diferentes, cuya dirección requiere un fuerte liderazgo y considerables capacidades sociales y de gestión. Justamente las capacidades que Fabiola Gianotti ha demostrado durante sus más de 20 años de trabajo en el CERN, singularmente como máxima responsable de la colaboración ATLAS de 2009 a 2013. Antes de llegar al CERN, Fabiola Gianotti hizo su doctorado en Ciencias Físicas en la Universidad de Milán, 1989, tras haber cursado un bachillerato de letras y completado los estudios de piano en el Conservatorio de Milán. Su biografía, por tanto, es la prueba viviente de esa afirmación que muchos científicos no nos cansamos de repetir, o mejor, estamos cansados de repetir en todos los foros públicos, de que humanidades y ciencias son parte de la misma cultura humana. producto de nuestra curiosidad, del pensamiento racional y nuestras ansias de verdad y belleza. Una identidad de propósitos, aunque no de métodos, desde luego, mil veces discutida por quienes tienen una obtusa e ignorante noción de lo que es la actividad de los científicos. Tras su incorporación definitiva al CERN en los años 90, Fabiola Gianotti ha venido desarrollando actividades de investigación y desarrollo y construcción de detectores, ha trabajado también en desarrollo de software y en todo lo que tiene que ver con análisis de datos, su interpretación y la derivación de resultados físicos relevantes. Se puede decir que su actividad ha cubierto toda la diversidad de facetas que caracterizan la física experimental de partículas elementales. Me excusarán ustedes de no detallar los honores recibidos y los méritos científicos acreditados en su currículum vitae. Ya pueden imaginar que son extraordinarios en la persona elegida para dirigir el CERN durante los próximos 5 años. Le agradezco sinceramente que haya aceptado la tremenda responsabilidad de dirigir el CERN, como le agradezco que hoy nos hable aquí del futuro del CERN y del LHC, recientemente modificado para operar a una energía doble de la alcanzada hasta el momento. Que nos desvele qué puede haber, en su autorizada opinión, más allá del Higgs. ¿Qué nuevos fenómenos o descubrimientos sospecha que puedan surgir del océano de datos que se van a obtener? Le deseo, creo que en nombre de todos, los mejores éxitos en su nueva función. Y por fin le doy la palabra. Muchas gracias.
Good evening. I would like to thank Professor Lopez for this very nice introduction. And I'm very happy and honored and pleased to be here in front of this very prestigious audience with the Secretary of State for Research, the Director of the BBVA Foundation, and many other prestigious guests, many colleagues and friends, and also all of you, ladies and gentlemen. So, it's a pleasure and honor for me to talk tonight about CERN, about the Large Hadron Collider, about the discovery of the Higgs boson and beyond that. And I'm particularly happy to do so in this wonderful foundation, which shares a lot of values with what we do at CERN. And we'll come back to this point later on, and to be also in this very nice palace. And also I'm very pleased and honored because the Spanish community, physicists, engineers, technicians, and also many young people have made very, very strong contributions to CERN activities over the years, and in particular to the Large Hadron Collider, including also the discovery of the Higgs boson. So I will start by saying a few words about CERN, although Professor Lopez already has recalled very well the history of this very peculiar organization. So CERN is the largest laboratory in the world for particle physics, and it's a very special place where over the past 60 years scientists from all over the world have made fundamental research in particle physics, awarded by discoveries. The Higgs boson is the last one, there were many also before, and Nobel Prizes awarded to people, several scientists from the laboratory. It's also a place where the scientific goals require the development of front-end, cutting-edge technologies and innovation, which is transferred to society. So perhaps the most famous example is the World Wide Web, which was introduced at CERN to facilitate the interaction among the scientists of the laboratory. And then since then, it has changed the way society accesses the information, and later on I will give you some other example. CERN is also a place where we train people, tomorrow scientists, but also students from high school, and also their teachers. And it's a fantastic place to bring, to attract physicists from all over the world, and so to bring the nations together. At CERN work more than 11,000 scientists of more than 110 nationalities. So just one historical slide. CERN was founded in 1954 by 12 European states. Today counts 21 members, member states, among which Spain. And the goal of the visionary founders of CERN, politicians and scientists, was twofold. On one end, to give back prestige to European research after the war. During the war, World War II, the axis of research had moved from Europe to the US also because of the emigration of the prosecution and Jewish prosecution, etc. But also, the idea was to create an environment that could foster peace after, you know, the disasters of the war. CERN budget amounts to about 1 billion Swiss franc per year, and I would like to stress that this corresponds to one cappuccino per year per European citizen on average. On average, because we all know that the cappuccino is very cheap and very good in southern countries, and then you move northward, and then the cappuccino becomes much more expensive and okay, disgusting. Anyway, so on average is one cappuccino per year per European citizen. So this is what we are contributing to CERN. This budget is shared by the member states in proportion to their income. So Spain contributes about 8.5%, and it's used to pay the salaries of the about 2,300 staff, plus the other paid personnel, in part, and in part is used to develop, operate, maintain the infrastructure, so the accelerators that are used by the worldwide community to do experiment and to do research at CERN. And this worldwide community, as I mentioned before, is made of thousands of scientists from different nationalities. You can see it covers South America, China, Australia, Russia, Europe, and Africa, etc. Now, if you think that these scientists are old and boring and old-fashioned, you are wrong. Because if you look at the age distribution of the 11,500 scientists that I showed before, you see that the peak is at 26 years. So most of the CERN population is extremely young. I'm also here, and I will not move from here. I will only stay. Don't laugh. Now, girls are at the level of 20-25%. At any given moment in time at CERN, there are more than 2,000 PhD students. If you ask yourself, where do they go afterwards? About 50% of them remain in research, university, or other laboratories, and about 50% of them go to industry. And they are hired by finance, by communication, electronics, engineering. So CERN is a place also where we, you know, form the young generation, regardless of whether or not they continue with science or go elsewhere. Okay, so CERN's primary mission is science. What we do at CERN is to study the elementary particles, among which we find the building blocks of matters, electrons and quarks, and they are the forces that control their behavior at the most fundamental level. So everybody knows today that matter is made of atoms. Atoms are made of a central nucleus surrounded by a cloud of electrons. Nuclei are made of protons and neutrons, and protons and neutrons are made of more elementary particles called the quarks, held together by other elementary particles called gluons, like the glue. As far as we know today, electrons and quarks are elementary particles. It means that they cannot be cut into smaller pieces. And they are the fundamental constituent of atoms and therefore matter. So everything, this table, myself, you, this little electronic gadget, everything is made of electrons and quarks. We are an ensemble of electrons and quarks and a lot of empty space. Now, particle physics at the modern accelerator and the most powerful and most modern accelerator is at the Large Hadron Colliders allow us to study matter, to scrutinize matter, down to scales of the quarks or even smaller. So down to scale of 1 billionth of a billionth of a meter. So accelerators have to be considered as giant microscope with very high resolution that instead of studying cells allow us to study the smallest constituents of matter. At the same time, these studies allow us to get insight about the structure and evolution of the universe. So the very, very small allow us to understand also the very, very big. And the reason is the following. We know today, from cosmology, but also from a huge number of experimental observations, that the universe had origin about 14 billion years ago from a big explosion, the so-called Big Bang. So at the beginning, the universe was very dense and very hot. It exploded, and then with time, it expanded and cooled down. But at the beginning, the universe was made of essentially three elementary particles. With time, these particles started to get together to form first neutrons and protons, and then nuclei, and then the atoms of the lighter elements. And then with time, the macrostructure that we know, star, galaxies, planets, etc. But at the beginning, the universe was just made of elementary particles. So by studying the elementary particles, we can understand the behavior of the universe, what happened in the early, in the very early universe. So there are two complementary approaches actually to study the history and evolution of the universe. One is to use big telescopes, and actually in the near future, one of them will be based here in Spain, in the Canary Islands. It's called CTA, Cherenkov Telescope Array. But these telescopes can explore the universe until a time which is 380,000 years after the Big Bang. They cannot go more backward in time, and the reason is that before this age here, the universe was opaque. Photons were trapped inside the universe, inside the matter, and they could not go outside, so they could not reach us. The only way to explore this epoch here before 380,000 years is to use accelerators. So these two methods are complementary. They're both important and both necessary to advance our knowledge of the universe. So how do we do in practice? What do we do in practice to study the universe in the early stages and other nice things? So what I'm going to present now is scientifically not rigorous. So I hope it will stay in this small room. Well, there are a few cameras, which I but anyway, because otherwise I'm going to be fired even before starting my new job. So what do? We accelerate two beams of particles, for instance, two beams of protons, and we made them collide. This is made by using accelerators. Accelerators are an ensemble of electric and magnetic field, which are usually housed in underground tunnels, underground rings. So, for instance, this picture shows the underground tunnel hosting the Large Hadron Collider. And these blue tubes contain superconducting magnets used to operate the Large Hadron Collider. So, these two beams are accelerated in the ring incrementally at each turn. At some point, reach very high energy, the highest possible energy that the accelerator permits, and then they are smashed. Okay? And so when they smash, it's like when you smash your Ferrari against the Ferrari of your neighbor, the two Ferraris goes into thousands of pieces, so to speak. And so you can see how they're made of. Okay? So we can study the fundamental constituent of matter, the quarks, the gluons that I was mentioning before, understand how fundamental matters behave. So this is the first goal. The second goal is that in the collision, you produce a lot of energy, and energy can transform itself into new particles. And the higher the energy of the collision, the heavier the produced particle can be. And so this is the reason why the Higgs boson has only been discovered at CERN, at the LHC, because previous accelerators did not have enough energy to produce the Higgs boson with high rate and in a considerable amount, okay? And third goal is related to the universe. The energy of the collisions provided by the Large Hadron Collider corresponds to the temperature that the universe had 1 millionth of a millionth of a second after the Big Bang. So I told you that the universe started with a big explosion and then it cooled down, okay? 1 millionth of a millionth of a second after the Big Bang, the universe had a temperature which corresponds to the LHC energy. So by producing this temperature and this energy, we can understand what happened in the evolution of the universe at this particular time of its history. Now, to study the products of these collisions in which all these nice things happen, what we do, we surround the collision point of the two colliding beams with big instruments, high-tech instruments called particle detectors, made of many layers of different materials, silicon, liquid argon, scintillators, etc. They surround the full solid angle, and their goal is to detect, measure, identify all the particles that have been produced in the collisions, and so give us a kind of picture, like a digital camera, a picture of the collision event. And once we have recorded the collision events, we can analyze the data and interpret what happened in that collision, what kind of phenomena were at play, and etc. Okay, now the most advanced project in particle accelerator-based particle physics is the Large Hadron Collider, LHC. This is a 27-kilometer ring, 100 meter underground, across the border between Switzerland and France. So here you see an aerial view of the region. These are the Alps here, Lake Geneva here. This is Geneva Airport. And this yellow ring indicates the location of the 27-kilometer ring, which is not visible on the surface, it's 100 meters underground. These little white dots show the border between Switzerland here and France. And so over the past years, we have been accelerating two proton beams in the two opposite directions. And these two proton beams have been colliding at four points of the accelerators, where we had excavated four big caverns and installed four big instrument experiments called ALICE, ATLAS, CMS, and LHCb. Operation of the LHC started in 2010, but it was preceded by almost 25 years of very, very strong, dedicated, and difficult work of the worldwide community, thousands of physicists and engineers from all over the world. It's a very, very challenging project. So it started in 2010, and operated until 2013. This was called Run 1, the first operation period, which was concluded with the fantastic discovery of the Higgs boson by the ATLAS and CMS experiment. In 2013 and 14, we have been in shutdown. We have stopped accelerators in order to bring some modifications and repairs to be able later on, this now, to operate at higher energy. And this year, in 2015, we have restarted operation with higher energy beams and a factor of two more energy, which of course allows us to perform the studies I mentioned before with many more opportunities of discoveries and many more opportunities of advancing knowledge. As I mentioned at the beginning, Spain has made very, very strong contribution to the four experiments and to the accelerator in terms of technology, in terms of industrial contribution, in terms of brains, in terms of people, in terms of young people, although, of course, also the senior people have been very, very important in this project. Okay. So a few more details about the technological challenges, starting with the accelerator. The accelerator is at this 27-kilometer ring that you can see here. Okay. And the bones, the core of the accelerator is a set of 1,232 high-technology superconducting magnets, which are used to produce very strong magnetic field and therefore confine the two proton beams inside the ring and bring them into collision. Being superconducting, they have to operate at very low temperature. Actually, they operate at 1.9 Kelvin, which correspond to minus 271 degrees, which makes the LHC the coldest place in the universe. Again, remember I told you at the beginning that the universe had origin from this big explosion, and then it cooled down and expanded. So if you ask now, what is the temperature of the universe today? The answer is 3 Kelvin. And the LHC operates at 1.9 Kelvin. So we are actually the coldest place in the universe, and also the coolest place in the universe. In each beam, at any time, when the beams are operating at the highest power, there are something like 200,000 billions of protons circulating in one direction and in the other direction, and they collide in the four experiment 40 million times a second. So I told you that these experiments, ATLAS, CMS, for instance, the biggest one, are like digital camera who have to take pictures of the collision. But this collision happens 40 million times a second. So this camera has to be very, 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 very fast. And although we don't record all the pictures, just a fraction of them, but nevertheless, this detector have to be extremely fast. Also impressive are the detectors. So this is the ATLAS detector. You can see this is a human being. So look at the size, impressive size. That's the beauty of this detector, to which also Spain has contributed in an important way. So the size is half of the Notre Dame Cathedral. And to remain in Paris, the weight of the other experiment, CMS, is larger than the Tour Eiffel and contains more iron. These detectors are enormous, but at the same time, they contain a huge number of sensitive elements to record the passage of the various particles. So they contain 100 million sensitive elements made, for instance, of silicon pixels. And in ATLAS, we need something like 3,000 kilometers of cables to bring the signal from the detector to the control room where signals are stored. And in 1 year, every experiment records something like 10 petabytes of data. I think everybody knows what a petabyte is, but if you wanted to write this data on DVDs, you will need a stack of 20 million of DVDs or a pile which is 20 kilometers high. So clearly the question is, why? So while we are doing all this, these technological efforts and this, so many physicists and scientists and engineers from all over the world working on this project, what are the goals of this project? Well, the goals are address some open question in fundamental physics that are with us. Some of them now have been solved, some others remain, and to advance fundamental knowledge. So the LHC has been built and conceived and built in order to understand, for instance, what is the origin of the masses of the elementary particles, for instance, the quarks and the electrons that I mentioned before, and this is related to the Higgs boson. And so this question has been in large part ticked off. I say in large part because, for the expert in the audience, the masses of quark electrons still contains a little part of mystery. But there are many others. We know today that 95% of the universe is dark. It's called the dark universe, meaning that what we know is only 5% of it. I will come back to this point later, explain a little bit more what it means. We know that the universe is made mostly of matter with very little antimatter. There is nothing wrong nor dangerous with antimatter. The matter is behaving very well as matter, but there is very little antimatter, and we don't know why. We don't know why. What happened at some point of the universe evolution, there has been an imbalance between matter and antimatter, and so matter prevailed, etc., etc. I will try to explain to you in just one slide and in a very simple way what Professor Lopez has explained in a more rigorous way scientifically, but I will try to explain in a very, very simple way why, what is the Higgs boson and why it is so important. So before the discovery of the Higgs boson at the LHC in 2012, we didn't know how the elementary particles acquire a mass. And we didn't know, for instance, why the photon, which you all know, this room is full of photons, is a particle that constitutes the light, is massless, it's just pure energy. Whereas another very important particle, perhaps less familiar to you, called the W boson, which is responsible for radioactive decays, which is responsible for thermonuclear reaction in the sun, which produce the heat that we all receive and allow our life. So why the W boson is a massive particle? It has a mass which corresponds more or less to 100 times the mass of the proton. And this is because in the standard model, the theory that describes the elementary particle and their interaction, originally all particles are massless. But this contradicts clearly evidence. And so in 1964, some scientists, among which Robert Braut, François Englert, and Peter Higgs, introduced a mechanism in the theory which would allow elementary particles, some elementary particles, to acquire a mass and other particles to remain massless. And so this mechanism, which is called Braut-Higgs-Englert mechanism, goes essentially like that. At the beginning of everything, at the beginning of the universe, of the Big Bang, before that we cannot go, we don't know what happened before, but when the universe started with this Big Bang, all particles were massless, like the photon, and they were running in the universe happily at the speed of light. With time, the temperature goes down, and at some point, and this point is 10 to the minus 11 second after the Big Bang, so 100th of a billionth of a second after the Big Bang, the universe reaches a temperature, okay, it was cooling down, reaches a temperature at which the Higgs field comes into play. You can imagine the Higgs field as a medium that starts to permeate the universe. So before that moment, particles were going around in the empty space, but at some point, they see that the universe is permeated by some material, okay? And then they feel that there is something. And imagine this material is, you know, kind of glue or sticky thing. And imagine the elementary particles are little balls. So they go through this medium, but they feel some resistance, so they are slowed down, and also they start to stick the glue and the marmalade and the molasses, you know, is this sticky medium, and they become fatter, and they acquire a mass. So this is the Higgs mechanism, a mechanism by which the elementary particle interacting with this Higgs field that started to permeate the universe at some point of its history, interacting with this medium, acquire a mass. The mechanism theoretically worked well, and it was at least the main solution to the problem of masses. But the problem was that, as a consequence of this mechanism, the theory predicted an additional particle, the famous Higgs boson. And since 1964, this particle has been hunted at all accelerators and laboratories all over the world until it was discovered at CERN in 2012. And this, of course, as you know, gave the Nobel Prize to François Englert and Peter Higgs. Unfortunately, Robert Braut passed away in 2011 before the discovery. Okay. So I'm sure I can anticipate your question. And the question is, who cares? Who cares of the Higgs mechanism, this medium, the Higgs field, and the particles? Who cares about the particle masses? Well, we should care, because if particles are not a mass, in particular, if the fundamental constituent of atoms, so electrons and quarks, are not a mass, atoms will not stick together. And if atoms do not stick together, there is no ordinary matter. There is no you, there is no me, there is nobody. There will be no universe as we know it today. Perhaps there will be a different universe, but we will not be here, and the universe will not be what it is. So we are what we are only because the elementary particles have some specific masses. And until some time ago, we did not know how and how this could be possible. Another thing that I would like to mention is that since 10 to the minus 11 second after the Big Bang, since this time, the universe is permeated by the so-called Higgs field, and is still now permeated by the Higgs field. There is a Higgs field in this room. If there was no field, the electrons and quarks in your atoms will not have a mass, because the mass comes from the interaction with the field, and so we will not be here. So the space is not empty. There's always something permeating the space. Okay, so you could ask, okay, but how did you observe the Higgs boson? How does it look like? Okay, so this is a picture showing the collision of two proton beams at the LHC in the CMS detector. So you see here the yellow arrows indicate the two beams which collide in the middle of the CMS detector. The collision produces many, many tracks, but you can also see these big green towers, which And these two green towers are the energy deposited in the CMS detector by two photons. The Higgs boson, once produced, disintegrates itself in other particles, and it can disintegrate into two photons. And so the decay of the disintegration of a Higgs boson will look very much like this event here. So what the ATLAS and CMS experiments have done, they've analyzed all their data containing, you know, photons and two photons, and then they look at the spectrum, and if there is nothing, you just see a falling spectrum like noise. But then if there is a particle with a given mass that decays to two photons, you will see it as a bump, as a peak on the spectrum. And so this is the signal of the Higgs boson. It was not easy to find it, because one detectable Higgs boson is produced every 10,000 billions of proton, every 1,000 billions of proton-proton collisions. So it's like looking not for a needle in a haystack, but a needle in many haystacks. And it required a lot of very clever work, a lot of ingenuity in the analysis to extract this tiny signal of the Higgs boson from the huge amount of collision that we have recorded. And most of this work actually has been done by the young people. Okay, so a little word about now the more recent, because this is past history. So the present and the future. In June 2015, the LHC started operating again after 2 years of shutdown and produced first collisions at an energy which is a factor of two larger than what we have been operating at in the previous year. And this collision was successful. And since then, we are operating in this new energy regime. So what are we going to do with this new energy? Well, we are going to address the questions that I mentioned before. You remember the list of questions. Only the first one has been ticked off, at least in large part. Another important question is the question related to dark matter. So I mentioned to you the problem of the dark universe. This means that when we look at the nice sky in the evening, so we see stars, planets, galaxies, beautiful sky, what we see by eye or with telescopes is only 5% of the universe. Okay, meaning that only 5% of the universe is made of ordinary matter, the same matter of which we are made. The rest is a question mark. We call it dark universe because dark indicates our ignorance. It's made of some form of matter and energy that we don't know. But also it's called dark because this matter and energy do not interact with our instruments, so we don't see them. And we infer their existence, for instance, the existence of dark matter, by studying the gravitational motion of galaxies, which indicate that there is much more matter out there than what we see. Okay? So today, based on many beautiful experimental observations and measurements, we know that 5% of the universe is what we see, the known matter, like us, made with the same kind of matter, atoms, molecules. 25% is made of an unknown form of matter called dark matter. And another 70% is made of an even more mysterious form of energy called dark energy. We have no clue of what dark energy is, frankly speaking. So in spite of the huge progress that we have made, there are still very intriguing questions to address. So one interesting possibility is that the particle responsible of dark matter could be produced at the LHC in this phase at higher energy from the collision of the proton beams. We don't know if it's going to happen or not. Depends on what really dark matter is made of. It's in the ends of nature. But if dark matter is made of kind of particles called supersymmetric particles, I will not go into details, they will be abundantly produced at the LHC, and so it will be really a triumph for science if an underground accelerator at the border between Switzerland and France, one can produce the particle that explain 25% of the universe. And our knowledge of the universe would improve from 5% today to 5% plus 25%, which is 30%. Okay. So one question that people often ask me, will the Higgs boson or other discoveries that you do at the LHC change our life? And my answer to this question is yes, and it did already. And the reason is the following, that in order to discover the Higgs boson, we had to develop high-tech instruments in a huge number of fields. Because particle physics requires really cutting-edge technology developed at CERN and in the collaborating institutes and countries, particularly in Spain. So these technologies developed at CERN found application in a huge number of domains, in particular in the medical domains, medical imaging, cancer therapy, etc. And I would like to mention one example. Today, on Earth, there are about 30,000 accelerators built by the mankind. Only a handful of them are used, well, not a handful, but a few dozens of them are used in fundamental research at CERN and in many other laboratories. Most of them are used for practical application. Actually, more than half of them are used for medical application. One example is the so-called hadrotherapy, where you bombard the tumor tissue not with with rays, but with protons. And protons beams are much more focalized, and so they just penetrate and bombard the tumor tissue and do not expand in the surrounding healthy tissue. Okay, so hadrotherapy today is quite developed, and I think also in Spain there are some ideas perhaps to build one of these centers here, and there are 14 facilities in total in Europe. So this is one example of application in medicine, but there are many other example. And every time, for instance, you pass through the security in an airport, remember that you are going through a little piece of CERN technology developed initially at CERN. So one slide to stress the important contribution of Spain to CERN in technology, in high tech items. Some of them are mentioned here. And here you can see the CERN beamline, which is going to be upgraded in the future to operate the RHC at more intensity and more power. And you can see a beautiful snapshot of the world, the little flag indicating the various magnets to which the various countries contributed. And of course, you can see here also the Spanish flag. However, regardless of this, of the applications that our discipline, of course, has and spin-off that it has on society, I would like to mention that fundamental research is the one that mostly stimulates ideas and creativity, because fundamental research is not driven by the final product. When you do applied research in industry, for instance, you have to produce some product, and industry has, of course, some goals of benefits, of return, of time scale, etc. Whereas fundamental research is free. So the fundamental research is where men and women exercise their ideas, their creativity, blue sky innovation, etc. Because there are no constraints. And ideas and creativity are the fuel of progress. And without ideas and creativities, without breakthrough, without big changes in our understanding of the fundamental principle of nature, sooner or later the progress stops. One good example comes from InstaRI and this quantum mechanics, which was developed and was understood mathematically at the beginning of the last century. Now, there is nothing which is most so far away from reality than more far away than quantum mechanics, because quantum mechanics has to do with the microscopic world. We live in a macroscopic world, and so, you know, how the microscopic world works has nothing to do with us. And there are some principles of quantum mechanics that are totally abstract and even counterintuitive. Okay, and without quantum mechanics, today we could not exist. There would be no transistor, so we will not be here with this nice webcast, etc. So, but quantum mechanics was a strong breakthrough. It was not just the evolution of something. The other example I like to give is the light, the electrical light that we is not by. I mean, the light we have in this room is not just the evolution of the candle. It's not that by building bigger and bigger candles and more beautiful and more colorful, you get this light. The light we have in this room has required a breakthrough in fundamental knowledge. So without fundamental knowledge, progress does not continue. It continues for some time, but then at some point it saturates and we don't move on. But I would also like to revendicate in some sense the importance of knowledge as the importance of arcs per se, regardless of progress, application and evolution, etc., because knowledge together with art is perhaps the highest expression of human beings are as clever beings. So it justifies itself by its intrinsic value. We are clever beings, which distinguish us from animals, although sometimes you ask yourself if animals are more clever than a human being, but okay, fine. But you know, our brain is our wealth, is fundamental, and not funding art, not funding fundamental knowledge is essentially betraying the essence and the human being. And I think these are very the values that I very much share with the BBVA Foundation, which, you know, I admire very much because it's really targeting fundamental research, basic research, the arts, which are really the most precious values that mankind has. I would like to quote a very nice quote, by Bob Wilson. Bob Wilson is the founder of the Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory. This is the second biggest particle accelerator laboratory in the world. It's located in Illinois, near Chicago. So one day, this was in the 70s, a delegation from US Congress visit Fermilab. So they show them around, very nice facility, blah, blah, blah. And at the end, one of the congressmen asks, okay, yes, this is very interesting, but what will your lab contribute to the defense of the US? And the answer of Mr. Wilson was nothing, but it will make it worth defending. So this is really the importance of what we do. So in conclusion, at CERN, in particular with the Large Hadron Collider, we are seeking answer to fundamental questions related to the elementary particles and the structure and evolution of the universe. And with the Large Hadron Collider, exploring a new energy frontier, of course, a very important jump has been made in this respect. The discovery of Higgs boson is clearly a step forward in our fundamental knowledge of nature. At the same time, we advance the frontiers of technology, also to the benefit of society, and we train the young people. Another important thing I mentioned at the beginning is the peaceful collaboration, but even more than that, we promote diversity. We promote diversity in all sense. At CERN, people from all over the world, not only different gender, age, ethnicity, work together, and diversity is a strength of mankind. It should not be an obstacle. Sometimes we fight diversity, but diversity is really a strength, is an asset for a richer and more stimulating environment, is an asset also for a better world. Thank you.